Yeah, well, I have actually been working in the fats area as well, and you're right. I mean, that is a fascinating area. I've been looking at a way of reducing saturated fat in food, and the reason why I'm doing it is there's this relationship between the amount of certain fats we eat in our diet and the likelihood of developing diseases such as. So, when we talk about fats, we have to be quite specific about those which are good and those which are more harmful. If I maybe talk a little about fats and oils. So we're probably accustomed to hear about saturated fat and polyunsaturated fats and trans fats. And maybe it's worthwhile just a little bit about that and then kind of what I'm doing in the saturated fats. So saturated fats tend to be derived from plants. Actually, at room temperature, they tend to be quite liquid. So olive oil, for example, sunflower oil, right? They're good for you, right? They have the effect of raising good cholesterol, HDL, lowering bad cholesterol, LDL. Then you've got the saturated fats. The saturated fats tend to be more solid at room temperature, and they tend to be more derived. And the reason why plant fats or the plant oils are liquid and the animal fats are solid actually comes down to the molecular structure. This comes down to the way they can be packed efficiently. So the liquid oils, they have what are called double bonds, and the double bonds means the molecules don't pack so efficiently. Whereas the saturated fats, you can think of them as basically long zigzag chains. They pack very efficiently, and consequently they have a higher melting point, which is why they're solid at room temperature. Now, saturated fats, they have their place in food. So, for pastry products, in bakery products, chocolate, right? Chocolate has saturated fats, and the reason why they have this pleasurable mouthfeel is because those fats melt at body temperature. I mean, they're specifically designed to do that. And that's, I think, also why. I mean, I'm not. I speculate. No one's told me ever that this is incorrect. But I speculate that if you've ever had chocolate in different parts of the world, they taste a little bit different. It's because they've been reformulated temperatures in the supply chain in those countries. So, chocolates in hotter countries have to have fats that have a higher melting point, so they don't melt by the time you buy them. Okay, so we've got the saturated fats, and they have a role, and there's a reason why you want your fats to be high for making particular products. However, saturated fats have some issues related to disease. And so what did the food industry do? They needed solid fats, but they were aware of the issue with saturated fats, and they developed a new type of fat. They took the liquid oils and they modified them industrially using a process called hydrogenation. That's a very technical term. But basically, it means it takes some of the double bonds and it gets rid of them and it reorganizes the molecular structure, and you get fats which are called trans fats. Now, okay, you have, I think, problem solved. Now you've got your plant-based oils. You've made them semi-solid because you put some of them into these trans fats. Problem is even worse, right? It has the effect of not only raising bad cholesterol, it also has the effect of lowering good cholesterol. So now you've got a double whammy. And by the way, the World Health Organization wants to eliminate trans fats in the next 2 years. And a number of jurisdictions around the world have been looking at phasing these out of food. So in the European Union, it's less than 2% of the total fat content in the food has to be trans fat. You can't be any more than 2% in the European Union. America, it can't be any more than 0.5 grams per serving. Now, what does serving mean? What is a standard serving? I mean, some people will have a bit of a serving. I probably would have more than one serving of certain foods with saturated fats. And in Australia, interestingly, there's no requirement to label. Unless you're making a health claim about the food, like it's low cholesterol or low trans fat or whatever, you don't even have to specify it. I suspect that will change though. So, trans fats, bad. So now you're left with a problem. How do you kind of structure food with liquid oils without resorting to trans fats? And I've been looking at a process called oleogenation. And as the name suggests, molecules that you add to make oils into oils, that is semi-solid. I started off doing some work a number of years ago with a very large food multinational. They had identified that if they extracted oil and rice bran oil, added them to another liquid oil, they could spontaneously form a gel. They didn't actually know why, but they knew they could do it. And so we used neutron scattering to measure so-called oleo gels, and we were able to identify and explain to the company why this formulation worked the way it did. And so the application in there is for cholesterol-lowering margarine, for example. But I'm currently working on a range of different possibilities for oleogel systems that ultimately be put into that. But you're absolutely right, Christina. I mean, the whole area around fat, very interesting one. Critical part of the diet, and it's just a case of making judicious selections of which types of fats you're consuming.